Welcome to the class, students. In this particular class, we will be discussing questions on heredity and diversity in living organisms, right? So before starting the class, let me introduce myself very quickly. I'm Vindhyara. We'll be taking a biology in this particular channel, Let's Crack Foundation and NTSC. I have done my master's in biochemistry, bachelor's in biochemistry, botany, zoology, qualified KSET exam, mentored more than 10,000 students for various exams like NEET, NTSC, NSCGS, and many, many more. But I am here to make you fall in love with the subject biology, because if you love the subject, you will be able to understand the subject better. So when you understand the subject better, you will be able to solve the questions of that particular subject, right? So students, also, if you haven't taken the subscription, take the subscription as soon as possible. So many of you will be the aspirants of NEET, JEE, also maybe CBSE 9th and 10th. So I will be going to talk about the subscription of different categories. So students, most of you, I know you are the aspirants of NEET category. So if you are the aspirants of the NEET category, you can take the directly, you can take the subscription of NEET, right? So also you get iconic subscription in the NEET category. So while taking the subscription, don't forget to use the code VRLIFE to get 10% discount, right? You can look at the price. This is for 1 year and 2 year. And this is the subscription of NEET, only NEET. But students, if you consider our category called as Foundation and NTSC Olympiads category. So here, even the name of this particular category is very lengthy. That is Foundation NTSC Olympiads. Yes. We will be teaching here for various exams like NTSC, Olympiads, CBSE 9, CBSE 10th, in addition to which we will be also teaching for NEET, JEE as well. But look at the price, my dear students. For 1 year, it is 15,750, right? For 2 years, it is 18,900. You may feel, oh my God, so much of cost. But students, so many exams we will be preparing in this particular category. Right? Not only just NTSC, but also for other competitive exam, including NEET and JEE, we will be teaching you in this particular category. So cost would be even less than one burger. So again, while taking the subscription, don't forget to use my code VRLIFE to get 10% discount. Also guidance for various exams. And also I will be providing you handwritten notes for CBSE 9th and 10th final exams. And students, iconic subscription of CBSE 9th category and CBSE 10th category has come up along with the creative corners. So you can take the subscription of that as well. See, I will be teaching in all these categories, right? And let's get started. Don't forget, students, my plus courses for NTSC, NSCJS, NEET, KVPY, CBSE 9th, CBSE 10th, everything have been started. Right? So this is the best time. And also, you know that I don't take much of, YouTube classes or special classes. I take more of plus classes. Yes. Yes. Let's get started very quickly with the very first question of, yes, heredity and evolution. So in this particular question, we are able to see the continuity of the feature from one generation to another generation is known as continuity of the features, characters. So option A says evolution, B is mutation, C is generation, D is heredity. So what would be the right answer? Continuity of the features from one generation to another generation. Very simple question. So this particular question is from heredity chapter. Everyone will be able to answer the question. That is, yes, you all know the answer. Heredity is the right answer, right? Next question we'll see. F2 ratio in dihybrid crosses. Very important to know that. What is the ratio of F1 generation, right? Genotype, phenotype. Ratio you have to know. But you know, we should be very happy that we should be feeling lucky. Phenotype. Array, spelling mistake. Yeah. Phenotype. So genotype and phenotype, both ratio of F1 generation is... There is no ratio at all, because we get to see all tall. We get to see all tall individuals in the F2 generation, students. So answer is going to be very simple, all tall. So genotype would be this one, phenotype is all tall. So there is no particular ratio for the dihybrid. Whereas if you consider F2 generation, ratio would be RATIO, right? F2 generation ratio would be, again, genotype ratio is going to be, yes, and here we are talking about monohybrid. So if the question is about dihybrid, genotype ratio is not being given in your NCERT. It is very long. It would be like 1:2, 1:1. So genotype nobody is going to ask, but genotype ratio, they will be asking you for monohybrid. For dihybrid, only phenotypic ratio, right? So answer is going to be 9:3:1. So 9 out of 16, 9 individual, 9 plants would be, if you consider the color and the shape of the seed, you will get to see yellow color seeds with the round shape. That is 9 out of 16, whereas 3 each will be able to show green colored and round shape, and yellow colored and wrinkled shape. And the last 1 out of 16 would be the most recessive, that is wrinkled green color we are able to see. So this is the ratio of phenotypic ratio of F2 generation individuals of dihybrid cross. Very simple. So this is the ratio of monohybrid cross of F2 generation genotypic, right? So this would be the epistasis ratio. 3:1 would be the, again, F2 generation ratio of phenotype. Okay, simple. Next question. Common sense based MCQ. GK question. Which blood group is called universal donor? Even if you have no idea regarding the blood grouping, you should be knowing universal donor, universal acceptor. So universal donor is which among the following blood group can donate to anyone, right? So very simple, answer quickly in the comment section. Which blood group is called as universal donor? ABO. Students, answer quickly, and yes, you all are right. The blood group O is going to be universal. Where is my pen? Yeah, here it is. So blood group O is going to be universal donor. Again, in blood group O, O negative is going to be universal donor, whereas AB positive is going to be universal acceptor. Simple. Yes. Next question. The total number of pairs of chromosomes in human being is, we all know that in the diploid cells. Yes, they're asking total number of pairs of chromosomes in human beings. So if you consider human being's body, what is the higher number of cells that we are able to say diploid cells? So the whole body is made up of diploid cell, whereas only the germ cell, that is the sex cells, are made up of haploid. That is, haploid cells are the cells which just has got one set of chromosomes. Diploid cells will be having two sets of chromosomes. However, the number of diploid cells in the body is more than the haploid cells, right? So total number of pairs of chromosome. So which among the following answer is right? So if you go for 46 chromosomes, it would be wrong, because the question is number of pairs of chromosome, right? So we know that in a diploid cells, we are able to see 46 chromosomes, that is 23 pairs. So right answer is going to be B. And next question, that is, according to Mendel, in monohybrid cross, the genotypic ratio of F2 generation is, according to Mendel, a monohybrid cross, I just told you just before sometime, I have given the ratio of monohybrid F2 generation, that is phenotypic as well as genotypic, right? Along with which we have discussed about phenotypic ratio of dihybrid cross F2 generation. So very simple, you have to note down, it is monohybrid and it is genotypic ratio, not phenotypic ratio, and it is F2 generation. Answer quickly in the comment section. Yes, you all know genotypic ratio is going to be 1:2:1. Phenotypic ratio is 3:1. 9:3:3:1 is dihybrid cross F2 generation phenotypic ratio. Very simple, right? Next question. In Mendel dihybrid cross, how many groups of phenotypic characters are found in F2 generation? So you all know that we will be drawing the Punnett square for dihybrid cross, right? Totally 16 boxes we will be drawing. The question is, how many phenotypic characters we are able to see? So all know that the ratio is 9:3:3:1, right? So totally 16 possibility of organisms, 16 possibility of the plantlets we are able to see, out of which 9 is able to show one particular character, that is round and yellow colored seeds, whereas 3 is wrinkled and a wrinkled shape and yellow color, whereas another 3 is round shape and yellow color, whereas one is out of 16, one is wrinkled and green. So we get to see how many characters. Very simple. Answer quickly. Ready, steady, go. 1, 2, 3, 4. Yes, 4 is the right answer. Very simple but very important questions. Right? Next question we'll see once again related to the same chapter, heredity and evolution. Yes. According to paleontological evidences, yes, identify the correct sequence of animal development. Very simple. We all have learned about these type of grouping organisms in the chapter diversity in living organisms. Fish, amphibians, birds, reptiles, mammals. Answer quickly in the comment section. According to paleontological evidences, identify the correct sequence of animal development. Quickly answer the question. Everyone know the answer. That is, answer is very simple, students. Answer is D. Because we group organisms into pisces, followed by amphibians, and then reptiles. Paleontological evidences is nothing but based upon the fossils. They have studied and they have confirmed that fish will be giving rise to amphibians, right? That is, amphibians is originated from the fish, and then amphibians gave rise to reptiles. Reptiles gave rise to birds. We also have studied Archaeopteryx connecting link between reptiles and birds. And finally, we are able to see mammals. So that's why answer is D. Next question. The cell wall of Rhizopus is made up of. Cellulose, suberin, chitin, glycans. Cell wall of Rhizopus is made up of. So cell wall has a particular component in the Rhizopus. What is Rhizopus? Answer quickly in the comment section. What is this Rhizopus? Yeah. Simple. Rhizopus is fungi. So fungi has got chitin in their cell wall. So answer is going to be yes. Chitin. Very simple, ma'am. Yeah. Next question. Which of the following animal possess jawless but sucking mouth? What, ma'am? Jawless? Yes. Very simple. Once again, which of the following animal possess jawless sucking mouth? Lamprey, chameleon, stingray, salamander. Yeah. If you consider the phylum Chordata, it is further divided into protochordata and vertebrata. Yes. Vertebrata will be having the vertebral column. Protochordata won't be having vertebral column, but it will be having notochord. It is primitive chordates. Yes. And under the, if you consider under the phylum Chordata, we get to see organisms like, yes, axolotl or lamprey, which all will be having mouth, which will be having teeth. But they won't be having jaws. Yes. So where exactly we get to see jaw? Jaws we get to see in the vertebrates. Right? So answer is going to be very simple. Lamprey. Right? Which will be looking like a fish. It is mostly aquatic. They are filter feeders. So they will be having the, circular mouth. So cyclostomata. Lamprey belongs to this particular group of cyclostomata, which will be having the mouth, teeth, but no jaws. Jawless organisms they are. Next question. Reserve food. I hope you got to know that from this question, we are discussing diversity in living organism. Till here we have studied regarding the heredity and evolution, and now we are starting with the diversity in living organisms. And next question, reserve food product of most of the algae is. So algae, yes, aquatic plants will be having reserve food. We too have got reserve food. Plants also have got reserve food. Algae also have got reserve food. So question is, the reserve food of algae is which among the following? Glycogen, fat, cellulose, starch. Answer quickly in the comment section. I know everyone will be knowing the answer for this particular question. And yes, answer is correct. You are right. answer is going to be starch. See, glycogen is a stored food or reserve food in the case of animals. Fat, in some type of algae, we get to see fat accumulation very rarely. Only few of brown algae may be able to show fat as their reserve food, but it's very rare. Whereas cellulose is a, it is not a reservoir, it is not a reserve food. It is present in the cell wall. Whereas starch is a reserve food of not only just plants, but also algae. Next question. Botanical name of tulsi. Tulsi. Everyone know tulsi, right? It is a, I can tell you, divine or auspicious plant, right? And also it has got high medicinal value for cough, cold, fever. We use the fluid or the juice of tulsi, right? So the question is, what is its scientific name, botanical name? Very simple. Saraca indica, Ficus bengalensis, Philanthus emblica, Osimum. Yes, try answering the question. You can guess actually. Answer quickly. Okay. Yes, Saraca indica is nothing but the scientific name of Ashoka tree. Ficus, you know, right? Fig. Philanthus, Philanthus emblica. Amla, scientific name of Amla. Osimum sanctum is scientific name of Tulsi. Next question. Which plant does not belong to group Thallophyta? Yes. Answer quickly. You know the answer, students. Thallophyta, thallus plant body. Yeah. I mean, the question is not belong to. Which among the following is not belong to algae? Eulothrix, Pyrogyra, Cara, Funaria. Very simple. You are right. Answer is going to be very simple. That is, our Funaria moss belongs to Bryophyta. Rest all belongs to Thallophyta. Next question. Find the odd one out. Adiantum, Equisetum, Selaginella, Rixia. Yes. What are these? What is that odd one out that we have to place? Yes. Answer quickly, answer quickly, answer quickly. Adiantum, Equisetum, Selaginella or Pteridophyta. You know why the name Equisetum? Because the plant Equisetum, they look like the tail of Equus, that is horse. They look the tail of horse structure they have, something like this. So that's why this particular Pteridophyta is called as Equisetum. And whereas Rixia belongs to liverwort under Bryophyta. The the leaf-like structures of Rixia, they look like liver. That's why they have placed under liverworts. Okay, they belong to bryophytes. Next question. That is, animals of which phylum are pseudocoelomate? False body cavity. Which among the following has got false body cavity? What is false body cavity? A homework question for all of you. What is false body cavity? Yeah? So what is the answer? Simple, Porifera do not have got any cavity because it is able to show cellular level of body organization. Platyhelminthes again won't be having any body cavity. They just have got triploblastic, three body layers, whereas Aschelminthes have got false body cavity. That is, we are not able to see true body cavity lined by mesoderm. True body cavity will be lined by endoderm and mesoderm, not just mesoderm. So when I say true body cavity, it is the cavity that is lined by only mesoderm. Even mollusk, annelida, arthropoda, echinodermids, chordata, they all belong to coelomates. That is, they have true body cavity. Next question. Example of perennial evergreen and woody plants. Evergreen, evergreen, always green. Perennial. That is, what is the difference between annual and perennial? Which is not annual. Perennial means which is not annual. That is, it is gonna live for more than 1 year, right? Woody plants. That is, the tree will be looking woody, right? Very simple, very simple. Funaria marcantia. Funaria is Bryophyta. Marcantia, again, you know it, right? Then, Marsilia horsetail. Marsilia horsetail, Pteridophytes. Marchantia funaria is bryophyte. Marsilia hostile is pteridophyte. Cyclospinus is gymnosperm. Eulothrix and Spirogyra is algae, thallophyta. So we know that we get to see the hard wood-like structures right from gymnosperms. So angiosperms are not here. So only gymnosperms are here. So answer is C. Next question. The example for egg-laying mammal. Are we able to lay eggs, students? We belong to mammals. We belong to the class mammalia. But are we able to lay eggs? I mean, I'm not talking about the ovum. I'm talking about calcareous egg. No. Right? But there are certain mammals which are able to lay eggs. Bat, kangaroo, pigeon, echidna. Yes. Answer quickly in the comment section. What is bat? Flying mammal. Kangaroo, marsupials. Pigeon is not a mammal. It is apes, birds. What is left one? Echidna, tiny anteater echidna. Duck-billed platypus. They all are primitive mammals because they are able to lay eggs. So answer is going to be chimpanzee echidna. Next question. Binomial nomenclature was given by the scientist. Which among the following scientists have given the binomial nomenclature? Binomial. Two names. Yeah. That is genus and species. Homo sapien. Yes. Canis familiaris. Pisum sativum. Very simple question. Very simple question. So answer quickly. Yes, you guys are absolutely correct. Carolus Linnaeus. He has not just given binomial nomenclature, but also he has given two kingdom system classification. Robert Whittaker had given five kingdom system classification. Carl Woese have given six kingdom system classification. Ernst Haeckel has given three kingdom system classification. Next question. Which special structures are connected with the walls of the lungs in the class apes? So walls of the lungs in the birds are connected by air sac, diaphragm, spongy bones, book lungs. Simple. Answer quickly. Very simple. Answer. You may wondering, right, ma'am, why the name book lungs? Actually, book lungs literally look like books. Yes, try searching the image in the internet. You get to see book lungs will be having the slits just like the book's pages. You will be like shocked to see. Yes, answer is absolutely A. That is air sac. Yes, air sac is connected with the walls of the lungs so that they can breathe and also they can reduce their weight of the body. Right? Spongy bones, or you can tell pneumatic bones are also present, but it is not related to the lungs. Pneumatic bones, that is hollow bones you get to see in the case of birds, which is going to reduce the density, or I can tell you, you know what, the whole weight of the birds. Next question. Identify the protocordate animal. Protocordate, primitive chordates, they are shark, frog, balanoglossus, rohu. So students, according to your NCERT class 9 standard, this particular answer that you're able to see is right. But according to your class 11 standard NCERT, this particular organisms have been kept under different phylum. Yeah. Answer. Simple. Shark belongs to chordates. Frog, rohu also belongs to chordate. Shark and rohu are fish. Shark is chondrichthys, that is, they are cartilage fish. Rohu is bony fish. Frog is amphibian. Balanoglossus belongs to hemichordates. So hemichordates have been separated from the chordata in class 11 standard NCERT, whereas in class 9 standard NCERT, balanoglossus comes under, yes, hemichordate, and that hemichordate has been placed under protocordate. So you have to follow your class 9 standard NCERT. So answer is going to be C, that is balanoglossus. Yes, hemichordates they are. They are half chordates. Next question. Obelia belongs to Obelia, Adamsia, and sea anemon, brain, corals, sea fan, sea pen. All of this belongs to Which among the following? Answer quickly. And yes, you guys are right. They belongs to mid area, also called as Coelenterata. Right? Next question. In binomial, we just have seen about binomial nomenclature, and I also have told you what is binomial nomenclature. So if you would have paid a little attention, you are able to answer this question now. In binomial nomenclature, the first word indicates species, genus, subspecies, none of the above. In binomial nomenclature, the first word indicates Homo sapien. First word. Yeah? Yes, you guys are right. Genus. Canis is a genus. Familiaris. Domestica is a species. Homo is a genus. Sapien is a species. Right? Simple. Everyone know the answer. Next question. Whale belongs to blue whale. Whale. Yes, very dangerous. Largest mammal in the world. I answered the question. Belongs to the class Mammalia. Right? Next question. Botanical name of neem. Very important. See, neem, Brahmi, and Tulsi. Then whatever plants that you're able to find around your home, no? You have to know their scientific name. Okay? Azadirachta, directa, indica, Pisum sativum, Cassia, Brassica, Campestris. Answer quickly. And yes, you are right. Answer is simply Azadirachta directa, indica. Next question. Which organisms break down the food material into simple substance outside the body and then absorb it? So basically the organisms breaks down, I mean the following organism, the correct one, will be breaking down the food material into the simplest substance outside the body and then later they absorb it. So basically they cook and they eat on themselves. But it doesn't mean that they are the photosynthetic, right? Yes. So very simple answer. Answer is saprotrophs, mushrooms. Cuscute is parasite. Ticks is parasitic insect. Tapeworm is once again parasite. So whereas saprotrophs are the one which will be breaking down the foodstuffs outside and then they absorb it. Right? Which of the following organisms have the nervous system at very primitive? Very important. So you have to know this particular, maybe you can by heart. I mean, many of you would be now knowing seeing the same question again and again as well. So which of the following organism have the nervous system at a very primitive stage? Yes, amoeba, hydra, earthworm, paramecium. Primitive nervous system, you know that is in the case of amoeba and paramecium. They are unicellular. Will they have primitive nervous system? Is there any possibility? Yes, you are right. Answer is B, hydra, because they do have got tissue. If you see just before hydra, that is porifera, they don't have got tissue, they just have got cells. Whereas hydra have got tissue level of body organization. So answer is B. Next question. Which is the smallest unit of classification of the organism? Quick answer should be like this. Which is the smallest unit of classification of organism? Genus, species, family, order. You just have to know kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species. You know now which is highest, which is lowest. Which is largest, which is smallest. Yes. Answer is simple, species. Next question. We just have got few more questions remaining. Students, which among the following is an example of amoeba? I mean, fungi, right? Anabena, euglena, mycoplasma, agaricus. Fungi, also called as mycota. Yes. What is anabena? Anabena is a bacteria, right? What type of bacteria? Bluegina, they are. Euglena is protists. Mycoplasma is the smallest living organism. That is, it is a bacteria which don't have got cell wall. Whereas agaricus is mushroom, belongs to fungi. Next question. Which characters are present in the vertebrates? Vertebrates. Close your eyes. Imagine, not why to imagine, when you yourself are vertebrates. Right? So you have to know the important characters of chordates. Okay, so that is presence of notochord is the very first feature. But unfortunately, in all the options, you get to see notochord. Next question, I mean, next particular thing that you have to know is the body layers. See, after platyhelminthus, under the kingdom Animalia, all organisms will be having triploblastic, that is three body layers. Right? So this has been sorted. Next is coming to body cavity. After annelidans, including annelidans, all the organisms will be having coelom, coelomate. Right? So vertebrates comes after non-vertebrates. I'm just talking still about the non-vertebrates. When non-vertebrates, they themselves have got notochord, triploblastic and coelomate, vertebrates should be having it. So answer is going to be notochord, triploblastic, coelomate and bilateral symmetry. Next question. Regeneration is found in. Everyone know what is regeneration, right? That is, regrowing the lost part is regeneration. So it is found in which among the following? Tapeworm, leech, hydra and ascaris. Students, you have to know first of all, regeneration do not happen in all organisms. It happens only in few organisms. So yes, you are right. Answer is hydra, because in this you get to see regeneration including planaria. Right? Only in few organisms we get to see. Next question. I mean, this was the last question for today. Yes. From the chapters Heredity and Evolution and Diversity. And yes, that's all for today. Let's meet in the coming class. But it's very important to take the subscription, because students, in the subscription classes, we will be literally covering all the NTSC chapters, and also we'll be solving all the PYQs, including and excluding this as well. And also NSCJS course, NEET course, JE course will be happening in the foundation NTSC subscription classes. And yes, it's very important to go for not 1 and 3, but either 6, 12 or 24 month subscription, because it is affordable. Also, we'll be able to complete whole syllabus in 1 year or 2 year. So while taking the subscription, don't forget to use my code VRLIFE to get 10% discount and guidance for various exams you will be able to get if you use my code VRLIFE. And also CBSE 9, the 10th, 11th, 12th subscription, as you can take up iconic subscription, have been started, students. So again, while taking the subscription, use my code VRLIFE. See students, if you see 36 month, 24 month subscription, you are also able to get access to 11th and 12th subscription. Yes. Okay, so that's all for today. Like the video, share the video, subscribe to the channel. Don't forget to use my code VRLIFE while taking the subscription. Bye bye. Have a great day.